Boy, they even let me use the fancy intro, huh? Nice. Hey, it's good to be with you guys this morning. And I mean that. It's really good just to be here with you. Thanks for making the effort to come and join us in worship this morning. Go ahead and turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. That's where we're going to be this morning, continuing in our series that we've been in. Just lost my train of thought. That's not good when you're getting ready to give a sermon. I don't know. I wanted to say something, and I forgot it. So we'll come back to that later. While you're turning in Ephesians 5, let me ask you guys a question. So whether you're married or not, let's pretend you're not. Now, you get married. You got married a month ago. Let's all pretend that, right? We got married a month ago, and our spouse is not acting like our spouse. They seem to want to marry us, and they got married to us, but they're still living like they're single, right? We got married, and we got this house, and our wedding is done, and our honeymoon is done, and we're home, and we're supposed to move into the house together, but they moved in with they stayed at home with their parents. I mean, right there, right? We're like, well, that's just not going to work. Or, you know, on the weekend, I wanted to go out with them, and, well, they're just still hanging out with all of their single friends, staying out till all hours of the night. In fact, this past weekend, my spouse went on a date. What's that all about? Right? Silly, almost idiotic that I'm presenting it. But I think a universal agreement is, well, that just doesn't work. You can't be married and be single. It just doesn't work. And maybe that's too obvious of an example, but I was thinking about that this week and thinking about the great messages we've been hearing from the book of Ephesians. And again, you look at the first three chapters. Be who you are. Well, it's not be who you are, it's this is who you are. This is what God has done for you, right? Let's not forget that we are blessed with every spiritual blessing in Christ. We are chosen, we are predestined, we are adopted. We are holy and blameless. We are co-heirs with Christ, we are saved by grace. This is who we are. That's the first three chapters, right? You got married, this is now who you are, you're a spouse. And so Paul is saying, in chapters 4 through 6, as Pastor Jeff has been unpacking for us, be who you are, right? We wouldn't tolerate our spouse acting that way. And Paul, in a parental voice, is coming across not harsh, but challenging and encouraging them at the same time of, hey, we need to continue to be who we are. And so we're going to continue to unpack that this week. But I want to ask you to do something with me. I don't know about you, but I've been in a church. I got saved at 14, so I've been in a I can't even do the math, 30-something years, almost 40 years. And I've heard a lot of sermons. Most of you probably, many of you've heard more sermons than I've had. And I know often you come on a Sunday and it's like, well, the pastor just told me something else I have to do. And next week I'm going to hear something else I have to do. And I've got to do this, and I should do that, and I got to do that, and I should do this. And I just want to challenge you to think about perspective for a second. This isn't the main point, but I felt like I needed to say this morning. See, Christianity isn't a I have to do this. It's an I get to do this, folks. If you're coming every Sunday and all you hear is I have to do this to be a good Christian and I have to do this and I have to do this, maybe it was a mistake in the preaching, and so forgive myself and preachers who've maybe put that burden, but if you're hearing it that way, it might also be a perspective thing. Again, who are we in Christ? Saved, redeemed, adopted. We get to do all these things that we're encouraged to do and challenged to do on a Sunday morning. And this Sunday's going to be no different. We're going to talk about some things we should be doing, how we should be living, being who we are. But it's the fact that we get to, folks. We get to because we're free in Christ. So with that perspective, let's dig deeper into Ephesians 5. Follow along with me in your copy of God's Word, starting in verse 15. Paul continues. He says, "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ." This is going to be our passage this morning. Paul opens up and says, look carefully than how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, right? Look carefully. Pay attention. You ever tripped? You ever tripped going up the stairs, down the stairs? You ever tripped on a sidewalk because one was sticking up and you didn't notice it? You ever tripped walking into a room because there's carpet there and you were on hardwood and you missed the edge of the carpet and you tripped? Some of us maybe many times. It's easy to trip in life. It's that much easier, I think, to trip spiritually because there's also somebody working against us. His name is Satan. Look carefully. Look exactly. Pay attention to where you're walking. I don't know if you've been watching the Olympics, but I caught some archery. I'm not an archer by any means. I was impressed with what these men, I was watching the men's archery and what they were able to do at the distance they were able to do it. But I noticed this one American, I'm watching him, and they'd be given, it was either 20 or 30 seconds per shot. And I noticed he would take every second of that. Like I was there watching, dude, shoot, shoot. Because if you don't shoot, you don't get the points. But he would take every second. And as I watched closer with each shot, he's got his arms out, right? And I'd see it drop a little bit and come back up a little bit and maybe a little bit right and a little bit up. And I realized what he was doing. He was looking carefully. That's what aiming is. Focusing so much in on the bullseye, but not just seeing the bullseye, right? But okay, now they've moved the targets back. It's the third round. We got to shoot farther. So what does he need to do? He needs to raise his bow for the drop that's going to happen. And the wind would pick up or let down. So one shot I watched, he really shifted to the right because the wind had picked up and was a little stronger. And then when the target got moved back, he not only came up, but he came to the right. And then as he was holding it, he shifted just back to the left right as he let go because the wind had let down. Just as he let go, he's paying attention. He's looking at all these little details. So we talk about living our lives for Christ. We need to pay attention. We need to look carefully, but more specifically, look at what? Look carefully how we walk, not as unwise, but as wise. The walk there reminds us this is an everyday thing. You can't just show up here on Sunday and go, I got it. I'm good for the week. I got my reminder. I got my energy. I got my Holy Spirit fix. I'm good for the week. No, walk every single day, every step of the way. Walk carefully and walk as wise, not unwise. He's basically saying, listen, as children of God that you are, as the redeemed that you are, you don't know it all, but you know a lot. You guys already know a lot, Paul is saying. So start act accordingly. Start living according to what you already know. Or put it a different way. Here's your big idea for this morning. If you're taking notes, you want to write it down. Conduct yourself according to the wisdom of God. He's saying walk as wise. Conduct yourself according to the wisdom of God. What you already know. That's what we should be doing every day. Looking at every step I take, every conversation I'm going to have, every thought I'm going to have, everything I'm going to do, everywhere I'm going to go, am I thinking about it with regards to the wisdom of God? That's my filter for everything I'm going to do today, tomorrow, every day. I run it all through the wisdom of God, right? He says to do so, but as wise. We've been given wisdom. Maybe sometimes you're like me and you're sitting there going, I'm just not that smart. Are you sure, John? Maybe God skipped me and he gave it all to Mike or to Brian or somebody else. I don't know. But we've been given his wisdom. The Spirit of the living God lives inside of us. You know that, right? The Spirit of the living God, the same Spirit that gave Paul his wisdom and Peter his wisdom, dwells in you in his fullness. And we're going to unpack that a little more down the road. You have wisdom. What Paul is really painting a picture here is of integrity, that our behavior would match what we know to be true. That thought can be overwhelming sometimes. Because I've heard many preachers say this over the years, and I've watched my own life thinking it's pretty true, that as Christians, we often know far more than we live out. We're good at consuming information. We're good at learning the Bible stories and the commandments and about the things we're supposed to do. We just don't often do them. Maybe we just don't want to because we don't like it. Or maybe it's too hard. Paul is challenging them. You already know so much. Make sure your behavior, make sure your conduct matches what you know, is in line with the wisdom of God. I love what Proverbs tells us, chapter 2, verse 6. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding, folks. By the way, if you ever feel like you're lacking wisdom, there go all my papers. You got one of these at home? We all have one in our pocket. You ever feel like you're lacking wisdom? God gave us more wisdom than we can truly grasp in a lifetime right here in this book. He's given it to us. And he says, again, look carefully. I want to come back to that because there's intentionality. There's proactivity in that. You can't just hope you look carefully. I don't know if I've shared this before, but I'm a runner and I don't say that like boastfully. I'm slow. Like 9-10 minute miles slow, right? But I do races because they give me a goal, they keep me running. I'm prideful and I don't want to walk. So like if I sign up for a race, it keeps me running because I don't want to walk in the race. I have walked in races, but I'm slow. But I like to do them and I look for challenging ones. And when we lived in Arizona, We were in the foothills, right? We had a, right in our, basically in our backyard was a 4,000 foot peak. We were looking at an 8,000 foot peak. It was just gorgeous. And there were great trails there. And there was this trail race that I like to run every year. And one year they decided to make it a nighttime race, right? Actually, it was a new trail that I hadn't run yet. It was a brand new, gonna be a nighttime race, 4.5 miles. And I'm like, okay, this is gonna be fun, but it's gonna be in the dark. But I don't know the trail at all. So what was the first thing I did? Well, I'm gonna go run it in the daylight. I wanna know this trail. Am I gonna be running through sand? Am I gonna be running over boulders? Is it tightly lined with cacti? Because that's not gonna be fun if I slip and fall. It's at nighttime, but it's the summer, so it's hot, so where might be places that scorpions and rattlesnakes are hanging out? Like, I wanted to know this trail. I wanted to be able to look at it carefully. I had to be very proactive. Otherwise, I was gonna go down and end up all cut up. And in that race day, we were allowed to wear headlamps. I could have skipped that and said, I'm good, I know the trail, but I didn't. I put the headlamp on, right? Something earlier in this passage about being the light or walking in the light, right? So had the headlamp on so I could see. I could have aimed it straight at my feet. Well, that doesn't help. I need to see out in front of me. So I could look carefully and hopefully not go down and hopefully not end up with bloodied hands and bloodied elbows and bloodied knees. Folks, we get to conduct ourselves according to the wisdom of God. We need to look carefully. We need to be intentional and proactive so that we can conduct ourselves according to the wisdom of God. How do we maybe more specifically do that? Well, let's look at the remainder of our time. We're going to unpack three opportunities that we have every day to do this. Look at the next verse with me, 16. It says, making the best use of the time, right? Walk as wise, not unwise, right? Making the best use of your time because the days are evil. He's basically saying, make the best of every opportunity. Make the most of every opportunity. Every single opportunity you have every day is an opportunity to walk according to the wisdom of God. It might just be a conversation with an old friend over the phone. It might be lunch catching up with somebody. It might be your job. It might be your parenting. It might be your marriage. But make the best of every opportunity. Really what Paul's conveying is our time is valuable. We don't want to waste it. We want to use our time for God's glory. Put it this way. Here's the first opportunity we have. Act wisely. That's really what Paul is getting at. Act wisely. Make the best of the use of the time, right? What you already know, act accordingly. This idea that making the best use of the time reminds us that time is short. Depending on your age in here, that, you know, for some of us, we're getting closer. Some of us are a long ways away thinking, oh, I got so many years, John. I got so many years. Time isn't short. I'm 18. I'm 16. I'm 25. I got my whole life ahead of me. Time isn't short. But we forget that this life, however many years we are blessed with this side of heaven, is the equivalent of a weekend for eternity. It is short. It's very, very short. We don't know when our end will come. Not only that, but he says what? The days are evil. Moral evil abounds. That's what he's saying. We are surrounded by moral evil. Some of us, unfortunately, are still maybe practicing that, and we need to stop, but moral evil abounds. I don't think we need to debate that, do we? Just turn on the news. Just pick up a newspaper. Just watch how moral evil is actually becoming legalized in our country. There is an urgency. The time is short. We need to act wisely. You know, it's funny, when we accepted the job here, I think it was right around mid-April, late April, early May, a lot of our friends in Arizona are like, what are you, nuts? You're leaving Arizona to go to Illinois? Didn't you hear everybody's leaving Illinois? Why would you go there? And as we took the job and met most of you, in fact, I remember the morning when Mike introduced Amy and I and said we were coming from Arizona, you did what you just did. You all laughed because I think you thought we were nuts from coming here from Arizona. Why would you come to Illinois? Everybody's leaving Illinois, right? Why? Because it's become so liberal and just sin is being legalized and all this stuff is happening. Of course, what better place to come and help advance the gospel, right? But that's what we need now more than ever, folks. Right? We need now more than ever in Crystal Lake and Algonquin and Lake in the Hills and Cary. We need now more than ever in Illinois and the United States. We need now more than ever believers who will conduct themselves according to the wisdom of God. Men and women who will act wisely, not trying to win arguments with the lost or the world around us, not trying to tell people they're wrong, but faithfully and humbly acting wisely, representing Christ to the world around us. And also, as Pastor Jeff talked about last week, exposing the lukewarm that may be in this room as well. We need to act wisely. Years ago, when we were in Arizona, we used to do every year we've done like a 10-day road trip all over the West, and we've had a lot of fun. And one year we went to Flagstaff, And we got to do this hike. We love to hike, usually up a mountain. Well, this one was down in a hole. We hiked into a lava tube, right? And so this lava tube, I think the picture, yeah, that's what we hiked through. That's in Flagstaff. It's 3/4 of a mile long, okay? Now, let me ask you a question. Just looking at that picture, would you go in there in flip-flops, shorts, a tank top, and your iPhone? Universally, I think we're all going to say no, except maybe like the 18-year-olds. Yeah, man, I got this, right? Because when we came out, we saw a bunch of 18-year-olds going in that way. It's 3/4 of a mile long, not super long, so you can maybe get away without water. But it is, you go through sections of boulders. This was an easier section to get through. Sections, there's no smooth spot anywhere. It's lava that is hardened. You have to go through boulders. Sometimes you do have to crawl. Sometimes you can stand up and you're in a room almost this big. But you're always on rough, rocky ground. We almost rolled our ankles like 22 times. Oh, and by the way, it's 40 degrees. It's 40 degrees down there. Like, there are signs posted online. Google it. Lava tube, Flagstaff, Arizona. All over the website, they're going to tell you, right? Wear closed-toed shoes. Wear long sleeves. Wear a hat. You might hit your head. Make sure you have multiple flashlights. Make sure you have water. Right? Act wisely. Take what you already know. And when you go to the lava tube, where you park, multiple signs saying all the same thing. Big sign. It's literally a hole in the ground full of boulders. You crawl down into this thing. Big signs all around it. Have multiple flashlights. Have water. Wear a hat. Wear long clothes. Wear closed-toed shoes. And as we were coming out, I lost track of the number of young adults going down there in flip-flops, and their only flashlight was their phone. No water, no hat, no long sleeves. Act wisely, folks. We're given tremendous opportunities every day to act wisely. The second opportunity is this, verse 17. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Right, and we're talking here, by the way, about God's moral will. Whenever we read about God's will, we can get caught up in, what college should I go to? Who should I marry? In this context, what we're talking about is his moral will. The things we know we're supposed to do, or maybe we need to learn that we should do or shouldn't do, right? And in fact, in chapter 4, we were told, speak the truth. We should do that. That's his moral will. Don't lie. We were told in chapter 4 as well, right? Don't tear somebody down, but build people up so that it benefits those who listen. We're also told in chapter 4, right, be kind to people and forgive people. As well, this chapter, Pastor Jeff preached on it, right? No sexual immorality, no crude joking in this passage. Don't get drunk. There are things that as a believer we should stop doing and things we should start doing because we get to. This is what he's talking about here. Do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Put it another way, this is what Paul's saying. Think wisely. Don't just act wisely. Don't just act according to what you know, but come to understand as much of God's will as you can and act according to it. Let's never forget what James wrote, right? The brother of Christ himself wrote this. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. Right? Notice the verse said, do not be foolish. The Greek word used there paints the picture of moral stupidity in action. That's how blunt that word really is. Like, this is somebody who you either know the truth and are flat out ignoring it, or you're like, well, there might be something, maybe I shouldn't, I don't, it's the whole like, well, I don't know. I don't know if I should or shouldn't do it. You know, so I'm gonna be me. I'm gonna just do what I wanna do. I'm not gonna take the time to go and understand what maybe I should or shouldn't do. I'm gonna just do what I wanna do. That's what all falls into this category. The whole, oh, it's better to ask forgiveness and permission. Love that one, don't we? That falls into this, right? I'm not sure if I shouldn't do this. Probably I'll ask for forgiveness. It doesn't go well. That's the picture here. Thinking wisely. Get to know what we don't know is what Paul is saying. Come to understand what the will of the Lord is. There's I mentioned road racing or running earlier. There's something, I don't know if you've ever heard of it, it's called the Eco Challenge. It used to be really big about 15 years ago. It's like the world's hardest adventure race. Depending on the year, depending on where, you have to do like 6 or 7 different disciplines. And so it was gone for 15 years. Amazon brought it back. If you have Prime, you can watch it. It's called the World's Toughest Race. Came on about a year ago. And it's like a 6 to 10 day race, depending on how fast you are. And it's like, this one was mountain biking, kayaking, open ocean, group kayaking, paddle boarding, rock climbing, swimming 8 miles in a 50-degree river. Like, it's brutal. It's absolutely brutal. And there's this one section in it. They're mountain biking down this, and they're on dirt, rocky roads, and they're mountain biking, and they're just flying down this thing. And this is like 6 days in. These people have barely slept. They've barely eaten. They're exhausted. And everybody's got cameras on them and around them. And you just see this. You can tell this is like on somebody's helmet, and they're mountain biking. You can just tell they're flying. And then you just see wreck. You don't know who it is. You don't know. And of course, it's like that's the end of the episode, right? Like, let's suck you in next week. And so it's on Amazon. So we just click to the next one. And it was the leader of this one team. He was a former soldier. I think it was either Army or Marines. Like, tough guy, great shape. A little older, but like just kind of, he was the leader physically, he was the leader as a whole, kind of driving his team. And those fast sections, they get spread out. So the other three are like, well, where is he? He was in the back. He had wrecked behind everybody. So eventually they turn around and they come find him. And as the first camera gets there, you can just see his whole left leg is bleeding. You can see his huge gash on his arm is bleeding. There's a lot of blood, right? And his first reaction is they pull up, how are you? He's like, I'm good. Let's just get this bandaged and let's go, right? Because it's a team race. It's teams of four. If one person has to stop because of injury or illness, the team's done. You can't keep going without him. So he's the team leader. He's been doing this stuff. He's like, I want to just keep going. Let's just keep going. Just help me get bandaged up. And he's wincing. And things look, his shoulder looks messed up, but he's just like, he's going to toughen it up and get through it. Well, then one of the other teammates who came in last or came to this section last, doesn't even look at the bike, doesn't even look at him to see if they can continue. Where's your helmet? She knows. You wrecked. Where's your helmet? Finds his helmet, huge crack in the helmet. She's had a little bit of medical training. She knows that he almost definitely has a concussion, right? At that point, you don't continue. But what I loved in this scene, this wasn't a man who was like, because she was like, you need to sit down. We need to get you looked at. He didn't just say, no, no. He didn't act foolishly. He tried to understand what was the best thing, what was the right thing. So after listening to his team, who all of them finally said, hey, listen, we're not experts. Let's get you checked out by a medical expert. Let's go back to the last checkpoint and get you checked out. If they say you can go, you can go. It's a beautiful example, though not Christians that I know of and not a Christian thing in the moment, of them trying to come to understand so they wouldn't act foolishly. How often when you come to a decision or you're about to maybe do something, you're just not sure, do you call your small group friends, your small group leader and say, hey, I'm not sure about this. Can you help me? Or do you grab God's word and say, maybe God's word speaks to this first? That's what we're talking about with think wisely. I want to think wisely so I can act wisely. And if we don't know, that's not a good excuse. Grab God's word and get into it and see if it speaks to your issue. It speaks to marriage. It speaks to relationships. It speaks to finances. It speaks to everything in your life. Grab your small group, your accountability partners, your discipleship partners. Call your pastors and just say, I don't know. Would you help me think through this? Instead of just making a decision on our own and having it go wrong. We need to act wisely and think wisely. The third one. Verse 18, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. Right? And yes, obviously, getting drunk, wrong. Not just with wine, but with anything, right? I don't think we have to argue that. But it's not about that. It's not about getting drunk. And by the way, I want to say this too. Like, if you read that and you're like, but maybe this is my youth ministry days, right? With students always trying to see how far you can go. Like, what's too far is too far, Pastor? Well, what's exactly drunk, Pastor? Like, is it one drink or three? If you have to ask that question, our heart's already in the wrong place. Can we agree on that? Okay, good. Let's move on. Right, but this isn't about, though this is true, it's not about drinking, right? It's comparing something, as all these verses have been doing. Don't get drunk. Be filled with the Spirit. Because what happens when you're drunk? You're not in control. You're just not. It's an absolute waste of time. You're not in control. But being filled with the Spirit, you're being in control of the Spirit. I said it earlier, you don't need any more of the Spirit than you already have. You have the entirety of the Spirit that Paul and Peter had. You have that same Spirit. He's saying, be controlled by the Spirit. Which, by the way, you want to be in control of your life. If you're somebody who's like, I'm a control person. I like to be in control. My marriage, our decisions, my kids and what they do and how they live. I'm going to control my finances. I'm going to control everything. Like, I've got it set up, and I've got boxes and walls, and I've got it completely under control. You know that's a myth, right? The only way to truly be in control is to surrender to the Holy Spirit. When you surrender to Him is when you will be most in control because, well, ultimately, He's in control. Put it another way. This is our third thing that we get. It's yield wisely, folks. We want to surrender to the Spirit's control so that our thoughts and our words and our actions reflect Christ. We want to yield wisely. Folks, you have to be filled with something. You're either going to be filled with your pursuits of the flesh, or you're going to be filled with the pursuits of the Spirit. And we become filled with the pursuit of the Spirit as we surrender and yield ourselves to the Spirit. As we do what we're talking about, thinking and acting, part of that is what helps us to yield wisely. I don't know if you've ever gone sailing. I've never been on a big sailboat. But when I was in high school growing up in Barrington, we lived on a lake, and you could bar, like from the boathouse, you could get a little sunfish. You know, those are like 8-foot sunfish sailboats. Only thing I've ever sailed. But I love watching big sailboats on TV, and you think of, like, if you think of really old sailboats, right, oftentimes there were guys who would row, right? You want to get out of the harbor, you want to get out of the open water, you row yourself out into the harbor. Nowadays, you look at a sailboat, sails are down, and they're running the motor to get out in the harbor. And when you're powering the boat, however you choose to do it, you can steer and get exactly to where you want to go. You're in control. You're directing the boat. You can get exactly where you want to go as fast as you want to get there. But if you pull in those oars and you take that motor out of the water and you do what a sailboat is meant to do, you sail, you're at the mercy of the wind. You can still get from here to there, even if I'm facing a dead-on headwind, right? You tack back and forth, and I can still get there. It may not be as quick as I wanted, may not be the route I wanted to take, but I can still get there. It's the same with the Holy Spirit. We want to let him lead. He's still going to get us often where we want to go, and sometimes he might say, you might want to go there, but you need to go there. The more we yield and allow him to fill us, the more we will, again, be in line with where he wants to go. We're going to stay on his path. We're going to be able to walk wisely and look carefully. We yield wisely by surrendering to the Spirit. Lord, not my will, but yours, as Christ prayed. So how do we yield wisely? This last one I want to unpack a little further because there's more in our passage. And I believe this last part gives us 4 disciplines to help us yield to the Spirit. And let me say, these aren't just disciplines that will help us yield to the Spirit. This is also evidence that we're yielding to the Spirit. When we do these things, we become more filled, right? When we're filled, we're doing these things. I hope that makes sense. 4 things really quickly. First one, verse 19, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Notice that first part, addressing one another. What we're talking about is fellowship. And that word, unfortunately, gets thrown around a lot in the church. It should, because it's a biblical word. But often we think, well, hey, I'm going to talk about how the Cubs traded Rizzo to the Yankees, and us Yankee fans are excited because they're better. Sorry, I shouldn't rub that in on a Sunday morning. But thank you. But that's not fellowship. Or we can get upset because the Cubs traded everybody away. Or we can talk about the weather. We can talk about the mayor of Chicago. Nothing wrong with talking about these things. That's not fellowship. Look at the passage. Look at the passage with me. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. When we get together and we talk about the things of the kingdom. We get together and we share our struggles in Christ and we pray for one another. We talk about what God is doing in our lives and we share our testimony of God at work in our own lives. When maybe we sit down and sing together or we just reflect on a passage of scripture together, that's fellowship. And when we do that, we are yielding to the Spirit because we're doing what God made us for. And we're doing it, it's also evidence again that we are being filled by the Spirit. It's not about Sunday worship, which this is again is a good thing, and fellowship can actually happen here. Let me just actually, I want to give you some kudos. Amy and I have been here 2 months today. 2 months today since we got here. And I love, right? You know, we said that some of the staff are going to be out to the right. We want to meet you after the service. There's been a bunch of, I've only been here, 8-9 weeks. There's been a bunch of Sundays I'm standing and I'm like, service has been over for a while. Where'd everybody go? Like, did they all sneak out the back door? So I come back in here and you're just standing around in groups. And there's a couple Sundays I'm like, what are they doing? I mean, I kind of guessed what you were doing. I'm catching up, saying hi. But what I loved is as I walked through, probably didn't notice me. I'm short. But as I just, yes, I eavesdropped. Forgive me, right? It's not a sin. As I just walked by, what I heard was, hey, can you be praying for us about this? And then somebody prayed for them right then and there. Hey, can I just talk? What do you think what Pastor Jeff said? I want to talk about that a little bit more. And then somebody else sharing about what God did in their life that way or how a prayer was. I was hearing the conversations. You guys are good at fellowship. I want to applaud you at that. But it's also not just a Sunday morning thing. The church isn't one day a week for 2 hours. It's every day of the week. We can practice this every single day. We get to practice this every single day. Second one, second part of verse 19, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. This is worship, folks. Again, you're great at this, I know, at least on Sunday mornings. That's one of the many reasons I love being up front, because I love it when you guys are louder than the speakers in front of my face. And you guys worship well. Singing to the Lord. But again, it's not just a Sunday morning thing. Learning to worship on your own. And I know right away some of you are going, John, music's not my thing. It's my least favorite part of the service. We're going to sing a lot in heaven. We're going to do a lot more than that in heaven. We're going to sing a lot in heaven. So you might want to work on that a little bit. But I'll say this, folks. Part of why we worship, and worship isn't just music. I know Travis would be like, you better say this, John, so I'm going to say it. It's not just music, right? But this is what we're talking about again. Singing to the Lord, making melody in your heart to the Lord. I can open up scripture and just read passages about God's greatness. In Jude, at the end of Jude, right, to him be glory and majesty and dominion and honor for all time and forever. That's worship. Just by reading that or reciting it out loud or sitting maybe in my dining room by myself and just saying out loud, God, you are sovereign. God, you are powerful. God, you are loving. God, you are gracious. God, you are merciful. That's worship. So you don't have to like music to worship. But to do this on our own, this is really painting a picture of doing it on our own, listening to it in our cars, whatever we do, but to do it with our heart. And let me say this, by the way, worship is a weapon, folks. When you worship privately, you will destroy doubt and fear and worry and so much more. Third one, third discipline, verse 20, giving thanks always and forever to God the Father and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Gratitude, folks. Gratitude, perpetual thankfulness, never stopping being thankful. By the way, this will destroy complaining and whining and pessimism and entitlement. All of that. You struggle with any of those? Become more thankful. Practice gratitude. Thank everyone you possibly can for everything they might do. Thank God for every good thing in your life. And you will destroy those things. And you will be filled with the Spirit. You will be yielding yourself to the Spirit. Last one real quick. Verse 21, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Often we think this has to do with the next passage. Though it's connected, this still flows directly from being filled with the Spirit. And a discipline here is submission. We practice submission. Scripture tells us, right? We're supposed to submit to God. We're supposed to submit to our leaders. There's submission in marriage. We're supposed to submit to authority figures. In any scenario where you might be under a leader, they don't have to be paid. They can be a volunteer leader, but you've chosen to put yourself under them. We submit to them. It's a word that we don't like in our culture, but it's a word that God loves because he put it in his word. He put it throughout his word. God loves submission. It's one of the ways we yield to the Spirit. And by the way, this is where most division comes from, when churches split, when people leave for selfish reasons. It's often because I don't want to submit. But when we submit, we destroy arrogance and we destroy pride and we destroy selfishness, folks. Those are the disciplines that we can practice to help us yield to the Spirit. I love this reminder this morning. I've been convicted in a lot of ways about the wisdom of God and learning to walk in his wisdom. James 3 tells us this. I love this. Brother of Christ, again writing, but the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. Want more of that in your life? I know I do. I want as much of that I can get this side of heaven. And the best way to do that is to conduct myself, to conduct ourselves according to the wisdom of God. To act wisely, to think wisely, and to yield wisely. Amen? Would you stand and pray with me? Father, thank you for your word. God, you have chosen not just to save us, not just to redeem us, not just to make us holy and blameless, not just to adopt us and secure us for all eternity as your children. You've also chosen to give us your word, to teach us about you, that teaches us all of this and so much more. You have given us your wisdom, not all of it, but more than we can grasp this side of heaven. We cannot thank you enough for your wisdom. Your wisdom that guides us, your wisdom that saves us, your wisdom that helps us to be more and more sanctified this side of heaven, your wisdom that helps helps us learn that we are set free from the flesh. Your wisdom that helps us learn that we are children of God, sealed and secured forever. Your wisdom that helps us know that we get to walk in your Spirit and be filled with your Spirit. Your wisdom teaches us that we need to think and act differently because of Christ, and we get to do these things. God, your word is a gift, just as your Son was the greatest of gifts, so that we might live. And you didn't just save us for eternity. Well, you did save us for eternity, and that includes life this side of heaven. We get to live as your children. We get to live differently than the world around us. We get to think like you, Jesus. We get to speak like you, Jesus. We get to act like you, Jesus. And we get to surrender to the Spirit, Jesus, just as you surrendered to the will of the Father, we get to surrender to the Spirit that you would be made more manifest in us. We cannot thank you and praise you enough. Father, help us to live as Jesus lived. Help us to think like you and act like you. Help us to surrender, God. Show us right now in this moment maybe what changes we need to make. What wisdom do we already know that we need to act accordingly? God, help us to have the courage to ask for help if we don't know the wisdom, the courage to seek out the wisdom and not just make a decision. And God, surrendering to the Spirit, I think, is the hardest piece because we want to be in control, but help us to let go and trust you, I pray, Jesus. Have your way in us, Jesus. Build Christ in me. We ask and we pray in your great name. Amen.